There is no one brake pad that solves everyone's problems, which is why you get on the internet and there's 10 different people recommending different pads and each one of them has something bad to say about the other. It's just a case of trial and error.
When we take one of those cars into a performance application, the brake pads, the rotors, other parts of the braking system on a factory vehicle, what are the common failure points that we see?
Look, I think most people look at trying to find a pad that does it all, and realistically that just isn't possible. If you want a pad that's going to last on the track, it's generally going to make more noise. It might chew through rotors. With pads, often we get people coming through saying, we want less dust, we want more bite, but then they get that and on the street it doesn't perform or it makes noise and they complain about it. So I think when people are building cars, they really need to go, this is what the main purpose of the car is, and then either drive around it if you are more street orientated, or if it's more a track orientated car, live with the compromise of it being noisy or dusty out on the street.
So generally for a motorsport application, the higher friction pads that produce a higher coefficient of friction, that is going to happen at a much higher operating temperature. Does that mean that they're generally not going to be as capable of producing that amount of friction if they produce that friction from a cold temperature?
Yeah, correct. So generally on a track you want a higher coefficient of friction. On a street pad you don't have that same level. You generally want something that's a little more progressive, nice and smooth, and that's just not going to perform the same on the track. Race pads will tend to have a bit more of a metallic makeup rather than being a ceramic. So yeah, it's just another compromise people need to make.
What are the kind of different types we hear? Metallic, ceramic, what does all that mean?
Ceramic are a ceramic compound. They generally produce less dust, they're a bit more friendly on rotors, they're great for a daily sort of car, whereas your metallic or race compounds, they tend to be a little more aggressive, they'll chew through rotors a little more and perform better on track.
So it is possible to get a pad compound that's in between for a performance street car?
Yeah, so we use Project Mu HCEP on the car Eleanor's i20N. That has an operating temperature of between 0 to 600. The HC Plus is 0 to 800. That pad performs fine on the street. It can be a little bit noisy, but then stepping up you have like Club Racer, which will be 50 to 850 degrees. That doesn't perform quite as well on the street, but is better on track. So you can get the compromise. It's not going to be perfect for daily use and it's not going to be perfect for track.
In a street car where you're going to run into brake fade issues at that higher temperature, if you want to maintain the comfort, the low brake dust, the noise aspects, focus more on things like ducting and stuff.
Yes.
To keep.
So people then need to have a look at, I mean, brake fluid is obviously one thing that you can do. That doesn't actually help with cooling the pad though, so you need to look at ducting. Even wheel choice can have a bit of an effect. If you have big heavy wheels on it with not a lot of space, it's going to help cook the rotor and pad. Yeah, so like there's a few options to try and bring the temperature down. And then also just driving style. A lot of the times people who are new to track work end up just cooking their brakes because they don't actually know how to apply the brake and how to release the brake. So there's a few ways and you probably need to talk to an expert and work out what's going on. And even guys that race at the track to try and learn how to actually apply and release the brake, which can help a lot.
Or do you ever use a different pad in the front to the back, or is it ideal situation to use the same?
No, we always use a different pad between the front and back, particularly depending on the drivetrain type. That can also affect it in the weight balance of the vehicle. Usually you'll have a higher coefficient of friction pad on the front and something a little gentler on the rear. So like on these two cars, we use the OEM factory pads on the rear because they're front wheel drive, the back doesn't do a hell of a lot.
So just backing up a little bit before, you mentioned brake fluid. Yes. And changing that. Is the brake fluid that comes in a factory vehicle not up to performance application driving on track, and what changes need to be made?
Look, I mean, you've got OEM manufacturers are trying to keep costs to a minimum, so they use a relatively cheap off-the-shelf brake fluid. You can have a look. You've got obviously your wet and dry boiling point that you need to take into consideration. If you go to a more performance orientated brake fluid, you're going to have to probably change it more frequently because it's going to be more hygroscopic. That's something that you need to take into account.
Can we just cover that term hygroscopic and what that means?
So hygroscopic is basically a fluid that will absorb water.
So the more water that you absorb, the lower the boiling point?
Correct. So that's what you have with the wet boiling point figure, is where it's absorbed more water, and that will drastically change the performance of the brake fluid. So like the Project Mu G4335 has a 335 degree dry boiling point, and I think it's down around 230 once it reaches a certain percentage of water within the system.
The brake fluid itself, I mean, the issue, if it boils and overheats, can you just explain that?
If it's got more water in it, it will boil and you'll lose braking pressure essentially. So the fluid gets pushed against the back of the piston, which if the fluid's boiling, it turns into steam and it's not going to work.
No longer incompressible, and its transfer of pressure is less effective.
Exactly.
The last thing I want to discuss is the actual feel of the brakes. That's something that's discussed a lot, the bite of the brake pad. What does all this mean? What should people be looking for? Is it different for each particular vehicle and driving style?
Look, it's definitely different for each vehicle and driving style. I think a lot of people kind of revert to the internet and get an opinion off their friend or whatever. The best way to do it is really just try things. Different brake pads will perform differently on different rotors. How you drive and how you release the brake pedal will also determine what kind of brake pad that you need to use. It's really trial and error. There is no one brake pad that solves everyone's problems or works for everyone, which is why you get on the internet and there's 10 different people recommending different pads, and each one of them has something bad to say about the other. It's just a case of trial and error.
That makes a lot of sense. If anyone wants to follow along with Semi-Pro Motorsports and what you're doing, where can they do that?
So just Semi-Pro Motorsport, that's pretty much the handles on all my websites, or Andrew Price Racing is the other place you can follow along.
Thanks for your time.
Cheers. Thanks, Connor.